Raymond, thank you. Dun dun dun, now is the moment that we've all been waiting for. It's time for our keynote speaker. I get the pleasure of introducing him. I playfully like to call him Ip Man, because not because he's like Donnie Yen from that awesome set of movies which I cry every time I watch, but it's actually because I believe he is the co-CEO of Synopsys, which says enough about how legit he is. Specifically, one of the things that he did is that he pushed for the introduction into the IP market. I think IP stands for intellectual property. I usually like to tell my boss that this is so much intellectual property, you better take good care of it. Now, I also want to give a special shout out to my Chinese school, which is called Xigu Zhongwen Xueqiao. Without them, I would not have known this guy's name. I believe it is Chen Zhiquan. So if I said it right, thank you. I feel very proud already. Now, without further ado, let's welcome him to the stage for his keynote speech.
Hello, good evening. The theme of this talk is inspiration. I'm really inspired by all of you. Actually, thank you, Raymond and Andrew. And actually, when I first heard this, that I was to be keynote speaker, and Andrew and Larry came to my office, and I went back to see my lovely wife and said, they want me to talk about my success or anything to relate to success, right? She said, what success? You don't even take the garbage out correctly. So a very humbling experience. And even more humbling is today I see all the professors here, Professor Chen Minghu from Berkeley, Professor Zhao from Tsinghua, all my professor friends from San Jose State there. So I was going to give a 30-minute technical talk and a 5-minute on my personal life, but I'm changing it to 35-minute on my personal life and 2-minute on technical talk. you cannot handle these kind of questions. That's why I got out of university and got into work. But I really wanted to share some experience today. The title of my talk was Change and Trust, Establishing the Foundation for Success. Okay, so all my talk on the technical side really is to establish what inspired me to get to some stage. And by the way, I want to make sure every time I talk to young people, and many people are here young, like last week I was at the Computer History Museum giving talk, I say the number one thing you have to remember, I'm not done yet. The history is still ahead of me. I still have 20, 30 years, so please archive this talk. So I have 34, so I will continue quickly. Okay, all right. So let's see. So congratulations for 40 years of CIE, as you said. This is a very special year. I want to look at the introduction of you started in 1979, very auspicious because everything is 9, like 2019 is pig. But 60 years ago was 1959, also the year of the pig. The last time was the in-earth pig, right? And all you know, Chinese calendar, very critical to be 60 year. Why is it 60? Why is 60 so important? Okay, because Chinese, I can't work this, so I can't even give my talk. Ah, there you go. This is a basic engineering requirement for me. I'm not doing very well. But, you know, Chinese do 10 stem and 12 earthly branches. So, you know, if you look at it, I know my Mandarin is not good enough, but I label them A, B, C, D to J on the top, 1, 2, 3 to the 12. Chinese year start with A1, then B2, then C3, and at the end you have J, which is the 10th, J10. Then the 11th year is A11 and then B12. And the 13th year is C1, right? So, law engineer here, how long would a 10 and 12 cycle get back to, what year? 60 is the least common denominator. Congratulations, that you learned that in about third grade. Okay, so nobody forgot that yet. So why is that important? Why is 60 years important? Let me just tell, where is the computer? Okay, because the IC started there, and this plaque is like probably only a few miles down the street in San Antonio near Costco where IC started. And that's Bob Noyce with the Treacherous Egg. Okay, I tried to make this talk. I know it's a Chinese Institute engineer. Many here, people here are not engineers. This is the beginning of IC. There are two major theories about how IC started. One is by TI, one is by Intel. I worked 9 years at Intel. There's no doubt Intel invented the IC. Okay, so, but why is this important? Why do I bother to introduce to you on this? Because this is the year of the pig. 1959 was the year of the pig. Let me give you a quick story why without the pig, there will be no IC. You might not believe this. But you laugh. You think that I make this up. I don't make this up. Bob Noyce was a student at Grinnell College in Iowa, right? And he was a senior. And his senior is a smart guy. His professor is great. In his senior year, he went to steal, junior year, gonna say, he went and steal a pig, okay? Because they want him to do a luau. He'd steal the pig and cook the pig. In Iowa, you do not steal a pig. That's a big thing. So he was really punished, but his professor loved him because very brilliant in physics. So as a punishment, they only give him a one semester of expulsion and no, cannot get into the city. And then he finished the next semester. And professor got him to MIT, and then the rest is history. So without the sacrifice of this pig, none of us will be here. So you gotta thank them. Okay, so thank you. Thank you, you're the pig. Okay, I will now, you want to have more story why that is the case, but we will now talk a little bit about the engineering side. Okay, if you look at the semiconductor industry, the history of semiconductor now, you can see it's growing steadily. It's almost reaching, this is a quarterly number, almost to 500 billion. But really, the semiconductor industry been growing as bits and past, you know, first with the PC, then the internet, then smartphone, then really the smart everything. And we all know why it pushes, but I just want to give a very quick shout out to the last one, which is because of automotive, because of AI, and because of security, and the availability of 5G, it allows us to get to the semiconductor side. You know, this might be boring to you, but it's very exciting to me. But where is the computer? Where should I be pointing this? Right back there. Okay, got it. So car, you can see one of the problems in the car is almost 30% of the car is now in electronic. More worrisome to many of you should be the car said it might have 10 million lines of code. Okay, somebody writes those software for you in those things, right? So that's one thing. The second thing is the security is important on the semiconductor security. So those are two things that are going to drive the semiconductor industry. The third thing that will drive us very strongly would be AI. And I think AI, there are many experts in the area. All I want to talk about on the AI is that it will be a fundamental change in many jobs. Many repetitive jobs will be gone. You know, creative jobs will not be gone. Jobs that don't care, where it doesn't need a human heart, will also be gone. Jobs that need a human heart will be there. So it's going to be very important. But the reason I put this forward here is really to say later on that one major thing that we all need is collaboration between many, many industries. And you'll see one of the things I'm talking about, how I found inspiration and how I think, is that we're actually at the verge of something new, and you will need new skills. And that new skill is based on change and trust. So I hope to establish this in the next 10, 15 minutes with you on some of this. So there is no greater time to be an engineer, I really think. I am very happy that I chose engineering and somehow survived in the industry, hasn't been fired yet, and can't say about tomorrow, there's a different story, but hasn't been fired yet, it's a great time to be an engineer. Why? Because you just, now, there are many types of engineering. I'm particularly in semiconductor, and on the axis is every quarter on the top is design. You basically have 90 nanometers, 65 nanometers, 32, 28, 7, 6, and Professor Chen Ming, who invented most of those things. So I won't explain those. You can go over to table 5 and ask him if you want. Okay, but why is this important? Because we are now, most of you are carrying, many of you are carrying 7 nanometer. 1 nanometer is 10 to the power minus 9, right? That's going to be important later on when we talk about center. How much accuracy we need. One hair is about 100,000ths of a nanometer. So that's how small a nanometer is. And of course, you know, atoms are measured in angstrom, which is 10 nanometers. So we're down into that range. And we are now designing daily with all my colleagues and competitors in this room here and customer 5 nanometer and maybe at 3 and 2. Hard to get further down because all of us worry about the power and battery in the cell phone. And if you had to split an atom, it's very hard to control that power. You know, nothing will save you if you split an atom, right? So, okay, so that's really 10 to the power minus 9. So I want to kind of move on this section by saying there are more 7-nanometer transistors than there are stars in the Milky Way. And I'll just end up by saying this on the change side, how much change there is in 60 years of change between the ENIAC and what you have on your cell phone, A12. The thing on the left is about 1,800 square feet. The one on your right you can put in your pocket. You know, the one on the left take 150 kilowatts. You don't carry 150 kilowatts. And the speed is tremendous. That's how much changes. Now, why am I going through so fast on these technical changes? One is, as I said, I am honest, all the professors are here. But second one is to tell you that change is coming, and how do we, those are just the last 60 years. The next 10, 60 years is even exponentially more. Okay, so how do you usually deal with that? And I am inspired by Bob Noyce. By the way, Bob Noyce, one more inspired is not that he graduated the last semester on time to go. What I inspired by him was his colleagues, his fellow student gave him the Brown Derby Award, which is given to the student that get the highest grade with the least amount of efforts. One of my motto in life. So I get inspired basically by a lot of people, and I want to share some of these is really from my parents, the lesson they learned. Okay, so one lesson to learn, well, before I get to the personal story, is really change and then trust. Trust in another major thing that is important. So everything changes. So the picture on the left there is the magnetic north. Okay, as many of you may know, the magnetic north has moved 30 miles this year, at the rate of 30 miles. It's moving from Canada, poor Canada, to Russia. Pretty soon the magnetic north is going to be there. The magnetic south, I don't understand this, most of you physicists will know, has only moved 3 miles. So I always thought the Chinese were smart. When they invented the compass, they call it the pointing south needle. They don't say pointing north, because the north is keep moving. I make that up. Okay, so so if that changes, you can see, one, why is there trust? I talk about magnetic north and true north. There's one thing you trust, right? The next thing is Uber. You all do ride share. When's the last time you really ride? 10 years ago, you cannot imagine riding into a stranger's car, right? So this is a very strange trust. By the way, my wife and I went to the Giants game, and about 3 years ago, I jumped into the Uber car. The guy looked at me, and this lady come in and almost smacked me with the handbag. She said, "This is my car. What are you doing in my car?" Okay, so you can no longer tell whose car it is, but you can do instead. The other form of trust is changing Airbnb, right? You are also changing trust. And this is inviting strangers to your car, to your house, right? So I'm saying, while there are changes, and all the other changes I just showed you are technical transistors, but even the form of trust is changing, right? A good example is the one on the left. If you look at, this is the picture of the kilogram. All of you know that, okay? Because the kilogram in November was told to be changed, and it was changed because this is a 150-year-old standard. All the food that you eat is measured against these 5 or 6 things made of platinum and titanium, iridium, in store in Paris, right? Every time I go to Paris, my wife goes to Chanel, I go see this thing. But it's being shaved off a few micrograms every year. And if you think about microgram, 10 to the power minus 6, well, compared to all the 10 to the power minus 9 that we need to preserve, it's not good enough. So basically, if you will remember Planck's constant. They have decided since, remember, Planck's constant relate the energy to the light, the photon, right? And since E equals mc squared, all of you kind of know this, since energy and mass can be equated, and now you have Planck's constant, which can be 10 to the minus 34 accuracy, you can take that, and now you can relate the photons and the frequency back from energy. You can actually measure mass, because already the fundamental unit of mass, length, and time, for the first time, is going to be based on physical constant that you can reproduce and not specific thing that you hold, right? The second is because of the time or speed of light, of course, and the media is how fast the light travels, etc. So, or the cesium atom. But Planck's constant, 6.6 times 10 to the power minus 4 something meters squared per second, either minus 1 or so. So, telling you that even the standards are changing. So this is the setup to talk about what my name is and where I came from, that there are changes in the basic changes coming on in all of our life, and even the form of trust is changing. But how do you deal with these two? What are the fundamental rules that you can deal with these two? So I will first start with now and then. Okay, this is Synopsys. I'm the co-CEO of Synopsys. I've been here 28 years. I'll explain that. Synopsys, for those of you who, many people don't know who Synopsys is, because you're a chip designer, you know us. If you're not a chip designer, there's absolutely no reason to know us, okay? we are a business in the EDA tool side for designing chips, the IP. Both basically, I would think 80% of you are carrying our product, because we make most of the USB for many of the cell phones. And then there's a software security. It's a 13,000 people company, $3 billion. I joined when it's about 100 people and 6 million. And out of those 13,000, that's why I love the professor, we're a very technical company. There's about 9,000 engineers, 4,000 masters. And like a small university, there's somewhere in the order of 1,200 to 1,400 PhD in the company. It's a very technical, very nerdy company. That's kind of why I'm here, I think. I'm not sure. But let's start with where time is on the, okay. So, sorry, I lost track of time. How am I doing? I'm okay? Okay, so just tell me. So, you know this tape, let me set up. There's Taiwan, Taipei on the top, and, oops, sorry. I don't want to go there, Taiwan, and then you see Hong Kong on the left, and the bottom there is Pratas Island. Right. So I was born in Taiwan. I'm 8th generation Taiwanese. And before that, my family, because Taiwan, the family book is very clear. I was 32 generations from Xiamen, okay, all the thing. And before that, apparently we went from Henan Kaifeng during the Tang Dynasty with all those problems with Turkey coming into China and all those. That's why we went to Xiamen and been there for 8th generation, into Taipei for 8th generation. So, why do I actually, I know when I speak, many of you look at my accent, sounds Cantonese, look like you are from Hong Kong. Well, how do I get from Taipei to Hong Kong? That was not my choice. I was in Hong Kong when I was 2 years old to 3 years old, somewhere between 2 to 3. I did not book the ticket myself. My parents told me that. And the reason I went there, and this relates to some of the lessons that I eventually learned, is my father has turned out to have the mining sea right in Pratas Island. Pratas Island, to many of you, will be called Dong Sa Chin Dao, Eastern Archipelago. And of course, in many of us, we now know where all the big problem is, the South China Sea, is the Spratly Island. It's slightly off the map to the south. It's South Sea Island where all those conflicts are. And if you go to a little bit more to the left, it'll be called the Paracel Island. That's called the Western Archipelago. This is a very small archipelago called Pratas. Father has a mining right from the basically from Taiwan and U.S. Army, because at that time the seaweed was great for mining to get rid of roundworms. So basically it was exclusive for that kind of medicine. Somewhere along the line, partner took off, the ships go off, could not find the ship, so my father chased him, kind of raised his own pirates or whatever to Okinawa, got caught in Japan, end up in Hong Kong penniless. So that's kind of, by the way, all the story I tell you, I hear every day from my parents. I have no idea it's true or not, okay? all the other things are kind of true, the professor can, this is unverified, ungoogleable, un-Wikipedia, you decide what you want to believe. But I can swear I listen to this every day, so I'm just repeating to you. So since Raymond asked me, why do I tell you, why is this related to change in trust? Because even early days, there's a lot of changes in my family. My father told me, always depend on others. Because by the time, we finally found those boats when I was in high school. But by then, we couldn't find the boat, and he ended up in Hong Kong penniless. Almost, and all the boats, I think at that time, we were employing a lot of Okinawan fishermen. So we grew up with a lot of Okinawan fishermen. The Okinawan fishermen was coming to Hong Kong to trade, okay? And what my father first lesson to me was, he charged 15% for the trade, the other guy charged 10%. But if they trust you, they'll give you 15%. Because 15% of $200, of $100, right? It's better than 20% of $10, because, you know, a trader trade and say, I sold for 100, but I tell you I traded for $20. So you get 20%, it's no good. It's drumming to me that in business, trust and honesty is a critical thing. The other thing that drumming to me is because I was always growing up with a lot of Okinawan fishermen at home, even when I was four, that drinking beer, getting drunk with Okinawan seamen is a very tough job for a little one. Okay, so always around the house. Okay, but what are they trading? Okay, Hong Kong was a very important construction time. You need the brass and metal, right? And Okinawan fishermen had a lot of brass and metal. Why? As you can see, because they all they had to do is go to the shore and pick up many, many shells that was left there. So that was how we trade. And eventually our family trade, and we got fairly prosperous. My father transferred me over to our family over to Hong Kong. That's why I grew up. My first language was Taiwanese. Second language was Cantonese. I learned English, and then I finally learned Mandarin when I arrived in America. Okay, that's why it's such a weird accent. But it's a different issue. But somewhere in the long of that, we become, as I was growing in grade school, our family is very prosperous. A lot of change because we had a lot of fishermen, a lot of fishing, going to the fishing fleet. And eventually, our family went bankrupt because the fishing fleet got too close to Vietnam. 1950s, you don't go sue anybody, right? So we went bankrupt. And you know, in Asia, when you go bankrupt, you don't just file Chapter 13 and keep your house. It's a great system we have. You know, you basically have a lot of problems. So I grew up a lot of changes, but I grew up a very happy family. You know, now that I look back, I thought my father taught me trust, but my mother taught me courage. Because I cannot imagine how you go take a family through these ups and downs, right? I mean, and my mother always said if she ever write a bio, she'll write under four flags. She grew up under the Japanese flag in Taiwan, then the Republic of China, went to Hong Kong under the British flag, and now under the PRC flag, right? So there's a lot of changes from all of our life. And I look across the room, we are all, besides transistor, electronic, there are a lot of changes in a lot of these things. So I can tell you more, but basically, before I go to university, my mother insisted my father take the first job ever he did in his life in terms of a job. He always was an entrepreneur and doing business because the last thing he ever wanted to do, we grew up with a lot of treasure maps. You want to come on because they figured that all the fishermen knew where all the sunken ships were from Malaysia with all the gold and everything. I think my mother said, this guy need to go to university, you better get a job and pay something. So here we go. I basically go west because I love, when you're growing up in Hong Kong, you love two things. One is reading martial art books, which is like Harry Potter, Go Wild, you know, but in martial arts. The other is Western movies. So always go west, young man. So I went to Rutgers. And at Rutgers, because it gave me the most scholarship, and we were always almost penniless, borrow money to get here. But the great thing was when I got here, I discovered that because in Hong Kong you go to 13th grade, you actually was ahead in math. And so after one semester, the teacher said, you cannot study, take the second semester math. You know, because we're in partial differential equation, they're teaching x, y coordinate. So I went to go to place the out of the class, but it cost $25. When you have $100, placing out two classes is $50. That's not a good thing. So I decided not to place out those classes. So I ended up learning, taking a lot of other courses, which is turned out to be useful. I was a musician, I took music courses and art courses, which I never would have taken, since on second semester I couldn't take second semester of math or just junior. So why am I telling you that? I always thought I was born lucky. For whatever happened, you know, sounds like a bad thing, but it's a good thing. It's a fantastic thing. And from there, of course, I continue to go west. There's slightly, you know, not too far this time, to Cleveland, where I got my master and PhD at Case Western. I did my PhD in signal processing I did my master on the light bulb. If you're interested, I'll tell you more about light bulb. But because General Electric, remember General Electric was a big company at that time, and most of the profit is in light bulb, and in the light bulb division is Nader Park in Cleveland, Ohio. Okay. But the most important thing in Cleveland is I met my wife. which I told you I was very lucky. Yeah, so thank you. And again, I haven't been fired from that either. So, so from there, the next one I jump in is west to this area. I was very lucky. The first job I got out of school was recruited from Intel. The, my boss at that time was Ted Hoff, who was the only fellow at Intel at that time, who did the basically invented the microprocessor. You know, when you get your PhD, you figure nobody really know what you're doing, nobody's really interested. These guys are engineers. They really, and after a week, he introduced me to his boss, which is Andy Grove, because Intel was about 300 million at that time. And I said, I'm not sure why I'm doing here. And then he introduced me to his boss, which is Gordon Moore. He's a very smart guy. And after a few months, he introduced me to his boss, which is Bob Noyes. And I thought, I found the pig. No, I didn't say. No. I'm very, very respectful. I'm Chinese, I'm very respectful. I'm only kidding. But you can see, I think I was just born lucky because I was, I think the most important thing I learned at Intel was trying to be very upfront and constructive, because Intel practices constructive confrontation, which is very much against my nature, you know. But now, it's very much my nature at work, but not at home. Okay, there's no the confrontation at home go one way. Okay, but so one lesson learned: a lot of changes, a lot of excitement. My next job, I spent about 9 years at Intel. And Intel moved our group to Oregon. I talked to my wife, doesn't want to move, so I went to NEC. Interestingly, at NEC, I was the head of the application team because I know the microprocessor, but then I become the general manager. But how did I get to NEC? Well, turn out, and I usually talk to the young engineer, when I was, because I was in research in engineering at Intel, every time salespeople bring some customer, they, all the R&D people are very busy. You know, I'm in research, so I'm always free. So they always say, can you talk to my customer? And I always say, oh, yes, I'll talk to the customer. Because nobody bring me to the customer, I'm in pure research. So at NEC, it turned out that most of the sales guys was Intel sales guys. So they say, why don't you come join us? So basically, I went and joined NEC. And then after 4 years, the first marketing guy at Synopsys was the first marketing guy that I met at Intel. And he came to me and said, why don't you join, why don't you come and look at Synopsys? So he did, last time I wrote the resume was at Case Western to go to Intel. All these are from friends decided to, because I didn't look for a job, you know, and so hopefully no Synopsys HR people is here, because when I when I first interviewed a Synopsys, he said, oh, you graduated from Taiwan University. I said, who said that? He said, that's what your resume said. I said, that must be true then. Well, hopefully nobody is here. So, but what I want to tell you is basically in this, I've learned several very important things, right? That you actually need a lot of friends, you need a lot of, you need to do a lot of changes, and you need a lot of trust that are going on. So maybe this is, am I still okay for time? I still have 5 minutes? Yes. Okay, I'm making sure I'm okay. Don't want to be fired from this either. But basically, I think all those three jobs and my job teach me a lot, that all the relationship you have from very long time ago, it's not that you want to use them. There is a benefit of being nice to people. You know, the person who asked me to come to Synopsys, I think I have not seen him for basically 10, 15 years. He was the first marketing guy, I was the first engineer, and somehow we reconnected. And it's true again for many people in this room again and again that I remember, Professor Chow, remember 25 years ago from Tsinghua. So I think there is one lesson that I have learned, you know. I think if I look for inspiration, I inspire my father who teach me trust, inspired my mother who taught me courage. So as I leave, I have 2, 3, 4. I'm being very Chinese in this. Let me just tell you how I'm going to end this talk. I love to learn one, just a quick lesson. When in A few years ago, I want to etch some glasses, but you know when you write Chinese character on the glass, you go the other side, doesn't look right, right? Then I got inspired by the oracle language, which is carved on bones, which is 35 years ago, is pictorial. So if you have a horse on this side, you go the other side, it looks like the horse facing the other way. It's not too bad, right? So I've been talking to you a lot about engineering. I usually, as this is Chinese New Year, and you end with a talk to a lot of Chinese studio, I want to do a very Chinese thing, which is give you a gift of word, right? This is what Chinese, a gift of word or a poem, and giving a word is very cheap, so it's very good. My name is Chi Fun, and at Synopsis at work, they call me Chip Fun, because of, but this is a very sincere gift, okay? So the work dog, this is the, oh, sorry, can you go back? So sorry. The word duck is mean virtual and morality. And you see the top word is how you write it in Chinese now. 3,500 years ago, or 3,000, actually it's not turtle language, it's more in the bronze language. It's written that way. And I chose this word because I thought living clean, giving, having virtual has its own reward. But the more importantly, this word is meaningful to me because, and maybe to you as engineer, because there are many ways to interpret it. You see the top part, on the top right part, with like a stone and an eye. Okay, there are multiple interpretations. One of that interpretation is that it is actually a plumbing line, you know, a string with a stone with a circle in the middle. It's the first thing they hide to see straight, right? And that word eventually become the word straight in Chinese. Okay, the straight, this is straight. It's come from civil engineering, come from those words. The one on the left is walking, how you walk, how you behave yourself. Walk, right? And the one on the bottom is a character for heart, you know? So virtual morality is something that's straight, how you behave and how you feel and how you bring. So I wanted to give you that word because it doesn't cost too much, okay? As a gift, okay? As I am talking about virtual and talking about changes, and talk about inspiration, I have two other foils. The next one, this one say, never stop learning. Jin Yong, I don't know how many people know Jin Yong, wrote most of the martial art, all right. You know, when I was growing up, these books were very popular in Hong Kong, was banned in Taiwan, banned in China, and actually banned in my home. My parents don't let me read it, so we don't read it all. But Jin Yong wrote all these books, got all these things, but one thing, he is also started a newspaper, okay, it's one of the most read. But one thing that inspired me is he got multiple honorary PhD from University of Hong Kong, from, I cannot count how many, UBC, British Columbia, probably 10 honorary PhD. In 2004, when he get the honorary PhD from Cambridge, he said, I will take it on one condition, you will let me enroll as a student. Okay. And in 2010, he got his PhD, okay, at the age of 86. Okay, so, and he earned it in 4 years. Every time I go to see my customer partner in Cambridge, I go to St. John's College to look at the stone. I went to Cambridge, but you can't read the, because you need a library card. Somebody who has relationship with Cambridge let me in. Otherwise, the PhD is not released till 10 years to the public or something. But it's very inspiring to me that's what I mean. And I say the history is not made yet. I mean, he has done a lot of things, but he truly wants to study. What also really inspired me is how his professor feels. You know, he wrote the succession of the officers in the Tang Dynasty. This guy is a world expert. How can you be his PhD advisor? You know, but he let him graduate. But I think it's fantastic. If you ever go to St. John's College in Cambridge, you should see it. So my last thing is to say for engineers here today, the reason I go through for so many things is because I think in this very strange, troubling, geopolitical time, one of the main things we as engineers need to do is to be a citizen engineer. It's a great book, you can download it anytime, called Citizen Engineer by George Papadopoulos and execs from Sun. Social responsible engineering means not only do you need to know engineering, you need to know the ecology, the intellectual property rights, business, the public policies, and how to collaborate, right? And I think this is gonna be very important. We have a lot, the reason I talk about trust in different forms, is that trust in formula, trust in transistor and physics. There's trust in human being. Engineers are very good at change. Engineers are very good at understanding what to trust, what not to trust. And I think we have a role to play, and the Chinese Institute of Engineers has a very good role to play in terms of the next generation of engineers and how they will affect society. So I'll summarize the whole thing by my last thought that said, the way I understand success is you have to deal with change and you have to have trust. And the way to get change and trust, learning, why we talk about Jinyong, why we talk about learning, you have to continuously learn before you can handle change. To have trust, one thing you absolutely need is courage. Because if you know it already, you don't need courage. 1 + 1 = 2 most of the time. You don't need courage. But to trust someone or to trust some system to proceed, you actually need a lot of courage. And I know that with this group, we can handle a lot of change and trust by having a lot of courage and learning going on. So it's a big honor talking to you. So thank you very much.
Hello.
Okay.
Wow, that was a really great speech. I think, I don't know about all of you, but one of the greatest things I got from that is that I gotta start calling you Cheap Fool from now. It's gonna be your new nickname. But really, I think what he has to say about the change, oh man, that's really good stuff. I think I'm gonna share that with my kids next week when I see them. But more importantly, we have Andrew Fong and Raymond here to bring to award Mr. I actually kind of forgot the real name. I'm gonna go for Cheap Fool for now.